Today I'm going to show you how I've made this huge geodesic dome. It's 8 meters in diameter, almost 5 meters tall, and made entirely out of cardboard tubes and wooden connectors. Each year our youth club organizes a small festival where we try to change our local square from something that looks like this, usually with even more parked cars, into something that looks like this. For this year's edition, I wanted to take it a step further by building a big geodesic dome where we could put our cocktail bar and DJ, in order to create a chill zone where people could hang out between the live performances. So I started doing some research. Rather quickly, I found a bunch of information on the domerama.com website, and I learned about the different frequencies a dome could have. Everything starts with a 1V dome. Here, all the rods have the same length. If you go to a 2V dome, you have two different lengths and the construction starts to look like an actual dome shape. The higher the frequency, the more your dome shape will approximate an actual sphere. But it comes at a price, because it will result in a more complex build with more pieces and more material and time needed to produce them. So in the end, I settled for a 3V dome, because to me it seemed like the best trade-off between roundness and complexity. On the Domerama website, there are also a bunch of calculators that help you design your dome. I chose the 5/9 Kruschke method. This will result in a dome with a flat base and will be slightly taller than exact half a dome, thus giving us a bit more volume inside the sphere, because the sides will be more vertical. For the size, I chose a diameter of 8 meters, which resulted in a height of 4.7 meters. This is the highest I wanted to go, because otherwise it might be too high to put together. When I enter the 8 meter diameter in the calculator, I automatically get all the dimensions and quantities of the struts that I need. So, it tells me that I should have a total of 165 struts with 4 different lengths. Now, if you have been paying attention up until now, you might ask yourself, wait a minute, this guy just told me that we are building a dome with a frequency of 3, so we should only have 3 different lengths, right? Well, since we are using the Kruschke method, it needs this extra length in order to result in a flat bottom. Now that I know the dimension and how much pieces that I need, the last thing I need to solve is choosing a construction material and a connecting method for the different pieces. I did some more research and I got inspired by the open source concept I found online under the name of Dome Nico. There, they used cardboard tubes and CNC'd connectors. Since the budget for this project was very limited, I settled for this method. I was able to convince a local cardboard manufacturer to sponsor us all the cardboard tubes in exchange for a picture of the end result and a time-lapse of the building process. And because I work in a fab lab, I have access to a laser cutter as well. I based myself off the connectors of the Dome Nico project. They have the STL files of their connectors on their GitHub. I imported them into Fusion 360 and started modeling my own version, with a focus on the laser cut process instead of a CNC milled one. We don't have a big CNC machine at our disposal, and I figured if I made the design in a thinner material, it would work just as well since the Dome Nico connectors were designed for a dome up to 14 meters in diameter. Using a laser cutter instead of a CNC mill also results in less setup time and a faster prototyping process overall. All the angles of the connectors are crucial. If they are only a tiniest bit off, this will result in a bigger error when all the pieces are connected to each other. Using the laser cutter will make this easy. I can enter all the correct dimensions and angles in my design, test it virtually to see if the whole build is going to fit together nicely, and only start making the connectors afterwards, when I know in advance that everything will work out in the prototype. Because the Dome Nico project used 18mm plywood, and we could only cut up to 8mm plywood with our laser, I decided to make a prototype to see if my design would hold up. Everything seemed to fit perfectly, and the construction also looked sturdy enough. So I went on and modeled all the connecting pieces and copied them in a huge pattern to double check that I didn't make any mistakes before I ordered all the cardboard tubes and made all the connectors. For the corbel tubes, I ordered the quantities and dimensions I generated using the calculator, and I made sure to subtract 240 mm of each tube to compensate for the length taken up by each connecting piece. Now for the tedious part, laser cutting all the pieces and putting them back together. This took ages. We needed 61 connecting pieces. This was literally cut, organize, glue, assemble, clamp, sand, and repeat 60 more times. I only sanded the center part of the connector because you wouldn't see much more once everything was assembled. Now the big moment of truth. Since we had all our pieces just before the event, we could only put everything together for the first time at the event itself. This is normally the one thing you should absolutely avoid, because a little more testing earlier on in the design process could have saved us a huge potential headache right now. But because of the production time of the cardboard tubes and the plywood connectors, we only had just enough time to get everything exactly right in time for the actual event. So I had to make everything as good as I could within this time frame and budget, and then just hope for the best. At first we had to decide whether we were going to build this from the top downwards or starting with the bottom and building it up to the top. If we could start with assembling the top pieces first and then pushing everything upwards, we won't need any ladders and it might make the entire assembly process a little bit safer. And despite all the videos that I saw online started from the bottom and worked their way up to the top, it at least seemed as worth a try. We were in only one layer and already two of the connectors snapped. Here you can see a very disappointed designer who just realized that the hundreds of hours and dollars he'd spent during the previous weeks might have just been for absolutely nothing. Of course it's much too late for a back to the drawing board moment now, but we were able to mend all the broken pieces and tried the bottom-up approach. And this seemed to work a lot better. It took us about an hour and a half to put everything together, mostly because we had a little bit of rain during the setup. The first two layers went together rather quickly, but as we made our way up, it became a little bit harder, because we had to put all the pieces together while standing on a tall ladder. In the end, we managed to put everything together, apart from the very top piece. The location of the top piece was too high to reach safely with the ladder that we had. But that wasn't a huge problem because the whole construction was sturdy enough by now, even without the top piece. And this is what it looked like during the event. The whole construction is sturdy when it's put together, but putting everything together without breaking it isn't always that easy. I highly underestimated the forces that are exerted on the connectors while the dome is assembled. The cardboard tubes are all longer than 1 meter. So if you try to move one end of a cardboard tube while the other end is already connected to a laser cut piece, you've essentially created a giant lever. A lever that can easily break the arms of your connecting pieces, apparently. The cardboard tubes came with a polyethylene coating from the factory. This makes them a little bit more moisture resistant, which came in very handy because we had a little bit of rain during the setup of our event. Luckily, this didn't cause any problems during the event. But some of the tubes got a little bit of rain inside of them, which caused them to expand. This, and the fact that the factor of safety of the laser cut pieces is just too small, caused the dome not to be so reusable for future events. Which was quite of a bummer, considering all the work I put into it. If I were to redesign this project into a reusable dome, I'd probably avoid using these complex connectors. If you're using aluminium tubes, for example, you only need to worry about the right lengths of your tubes. Just squeeze the ends together with a vise or a hydraulic press, and as long as the distance between the two holes at the end is correct, you don't have all these complex angles to worry about, because everything will just work out fine if you start connecting them in the right order. You can also just use nuts and bolts to put everything together, which is fast, easy, cheap, and sturdy. The only big problem here is that you have to source a couple of 100 meters of steel or aluminium tubing, which usually makes this a way more expensive option. All in all, I'm happy with the end result though. It served its purpose perfectly, and I had a lot of compliments about it. If you are inspired and you want to build your own dome, I made an Instructable. There you can find all the steps I explained in the video, and you can find the design files as well. You can find the link to this Instructable in the description below. If you want to see my other project videos, you can find them on this YouTube channel. And if you don't want to miss out on my future project videos, be sure to click the subscribe button.